Hello summoners, and welcome to our in-depth analysis of Faker's Zoe gameplay. I don't think this guy needs an introduction. He has achieved near mythical status within the League of Legends community thanks to his consistent godlike plays over the years, and especially that Zed outplay from Season 3. You know which one I mean.
Even though I only have a mat on the floor, I think he's in the bed. Oh, Faker may be in trouble. Your death mark tries to clean it up for Ryu. Oh, look at the cleanse. Look at the moves. Faker, what was that? Faker with a huge...
But today, we'll be covering some of his solo queue domination with one of the newer additions to League of Legends, Zoe, the aspect of Twilight. But before we get started, make sure to go to ProGuides.com if you want to see huge improvements to your rank right now. With the Pro Pass, you get exclusive access to Pro courses, and ProGuides has a feature called InstaPro, which provides instant, 24/7 on-demand coaching from the best of the best. Over 100,000 gamers have used InstaPro today and ranked up significantly, so don't miss out on this opportunity. Rank up now using the link below. Having said all that, let's first go over Faker's runes for this matchup and also cover a very interesting mechanical trick that he utilizes on Zoe. First, the runes. He went for Electrocute, Taste of Blood, Ghost Poro, and Ravenous Hunter in the Domination tree, followed by Mana Flow Band and Transcendence in Sorcery, as well as two Adaptive Force Shards and a Magic Resist one. The reason for Electrocute over something like Summon Airy is because of the matchup in this game. He is against Akali, who will most likely build Doran's Shield first item, so he doesn't want to poke down Akali, who will just regenerate all of that damage. Instead, his game plan is to assassinate targets when he roams. Taste of Blood was chosen over Sudden Impact since it gives very good value pre-level 6, whereas Sudden Impact is much less relevant to champions without mobility in the early levels. Ghost Poro is better than the other option since Faker is on a relatively immobile champion, and having that extra bit of vision to spot out possible ganks really helps. Ravenous Hunter is the only applicable rune for Zoe in that row, and Mana Flow Band and Transcendence will help him spam abilities in sieges. Lastly, he picked up an Adaptive Force Shard instead of the CDR one because of the instant AP for the early game. Besides that, he can easily reach the 40% CDR cap without that shard by combining 20% from Luden's Echo, 10% from his Transcendence, and 10% from a blue buff. And of course, the Magic Resist shard is there against Akali's magic damage. Now, for that mechanical trick, see Zoe's passive, More Sparkles? It means that after casting any spell, Zoe's next basic attack does bonus magic damage. And her Q, Paddle Star, lets her fire a missile that deals more damage the further it travels. You probably know about this if you've ever seen a Zoe in your games. The thing is, this ability has two casts, one for throwing the projectile and another one for redirecting it. Both of the casts of Q will activate the passive, meaning that if your fingers are quick enough, you can fire off two empowered attacks at the cost of one ability. Faker abuses this very well to get better trades and output more damage to towers. Alright, now let's jump into the match. Faker's starting build is a Doran's Ring and potions. Because of the recent nerfs to Corruption Potion and Time Warp Tonic, it's probably better to go for a D-Ring. After some level 1 shenanigans and his jungler getting first blood, Faker goes back to lane a bit faster than his lane opponent and manages to land a super long Q onto the minion wave, which helps his number 1 objective in this matchup. Can you guess what that objective is? Faker's primary goal as Zoe versus Akali is to push out the lane as fast as possible in order to establish priority and roam to put down vision or gank other lanes. He quickly does just that. This very deep ward behind enemy raptors, which he now places, will massively help him and his team in tracking the enemy Kindred, and sure enough, she shows there only 40 seconds later. Knowing her position, Faker can now play as aggressively as he wants. At the 5 minute and 30 second mark, he goes to place a ward in the river bush, but decides against it in the last second. Take a look at all of the game info on screen, and try to guess why he changed his mind so suddenly. The reason he did this is because of two primary reasons. A, Akali is not level 6 yet. The likelihood of Akali with no ult actually roaming bot is almost zero, so he senses that Akali may just jump onto him if he goes to place that ward. Reason B is because Faker's own jungler is currently ganking top, and he wouldn't be able to help him if he gets caught. Therefore, it's not worth risking Zoe's life just for a simple ward. Surely enough, playing safe does actually prevent a gank by Kindred from the bottom river. You can see now Faker hugging the top edge of the lane in order to prepare just in case Kindred is still around and wants to gank once more. Kindred does not gank, so it's back to regular farming. Faker then spots out Kindred in the bottom jungle, and he quickly pushes out his mid wave to gain priority and roam down bot for a skirmish. Even though he misses the Sleepy Trouble bubble onto Pyke, he instead picks up the kill on Kindred, just before Akali arrives late to the party and does absolutely nothing. Another interesting thing to note is that Faker grabbed Kindred's Red Smite and immediately used it on Jinx, which has arguably saved his life there because Red Smite applied 20% damage reduction on Jinx's basic attacks. After resetting, he pushes out the wave once more to place another deep ward, then he moves to assist another skirmish. Winning it allows Nidalee to start up and secure the Drake, so Zoe goes once again to clear the mid wave. Notice that Faker uses his Spell Thief Redemption on the minion wave instead of saving it for something more important. Can you figure out why he did this? Because one of the other minions had another spell to pick up, and also stolen spells and items only last 60 seconds for Zoe, Faker had a bit more time left on his redemption, but popping it onto the wave helps him with his primary goal of not only perma-pushing the wave, but it also gives him another spell for free, so that's why he did it. Next, we see him push a couple more times, gaining priority and netting more kills. Eventually, he gets to the tower, and now we go back to the mechanic that we touched upon at the very start of the video. As Zoe, when attacking the tower, you want to get as many passive activations as possible, including the double proc on your Q. It's like a free Sheen built into your kit. At the 14-minute mark, Faker is still pushing minion waves like there's no tomorrow, already with a 40 CS advantage over his lane opponent, Akali. But the way he pushes now fully utilizes Zoe's kit. He ults away from the minions, into the river, activating his Q just before he returns to his starting portal. Next, he walks all the way back to the minion wave, waiting out just before the Q timer ends and hitting the wave with much more power than a simple Q back and forward without the ultimate. This is a pretty risky move, but he was able to do it without any consequences. Why? The reason is because he saw three enemies bot side, and the enemy Renekton is dead. So he's pretty much alone in the mid lane, and that's why he was so comfortable using the full combo. If he didn't have vision over the enemies, this is a way of wave clearing that would be too dangerous. Wow, we've already covered the first 15 minutes of Faker's Zoe game, so let's do a quick recap of important moments thus far. He gains quick priority early on by pushing faster, which allows him to place a very deep ward at 220 in order to spot Kindred. He also decides against warding in the river because of a likely gank, and he guesses correctly. He gains priority again and uses it to reach bot lane first, netting him a kill. He uses a Spell Thief Redemption only on the wave, that way he could push faster and immediately grab another spell from one of the minions, gaining more potential out of this ability. He utilizes two empowered attacks from one Q in order to chunk the tower quicker, and thanks to good map awareness, he uses the full combo risk-free to get a more powerful Paddle Star onto the minion wave. Okay, let's continue into the mid-game. Zoe is not a very good split pusher, so Faker backs off into the river, pushing the wave past this line. This is a much better play because in the river, he can look to either find picks over the wall with his sleep, or to do objectives. In this case, he helps out Nidalee with the Drake, and since he's well fed, he moves slightly into the enemy jungle to scout out. There, he sees a blue buff for literally half a second, and what happens next, some may call the Faker show. Earlier on, he picked up a Chilling Smite on his Spell Thief ability, and so with perfect timing, he activates Q, jumps over the wall with the portal, redirects Q, and smites it away from Kindred. Can we just get a round of applause for this man? Man, he is too good. Anyways, after the steal, he goes to push again, but now he travels past that point over which Zoe should not push. Taking a look at the current state of the game and the position of his teammates, can you guess why he was so confident this time around? The best explanation is because now he has the help of Nidalee directly next to him, and besides that, he's also the highest level out of everybody in the game, so even if he gets collapsed on, he will be able to fight. And surely enough, Akali does try to assassinate him, but thanks to his level advantage, he can kill her without Nidalee's help. By the way, if Zoe and Akali were equally fed, this 1v1 would go in Akali's favor, so this just goes to show how powerful she can be if she's played correctly. After the kill, he is still healthy enough to push into the tier 2 tower, and since 4 champions on the enemy team are dead and Renekton is mid, there's nobody to stop him. He gets the tower and runs through the enemy jungle back to the river, almost killing Renekton, but finishing off Akali. A regular player would have likely recalled after the tower fell and looked to set up for Baron or sieging, but this is Faker after all, doing Faker things. So let's back up and see what on earth just happened. First off, he saw the half HP Renekton and ulted him over the wall, putting Red Smite onto him in the process for more damage. He does miss the Sleepy Trouble bubble, but picks up the stolen flash, using it to reposition south of Renekton. Let's not forget that anytime Zoe uses a stolen spell, she gains movement speed and 3 bubbles which act like Ahri's Foxfires. These orbit around Zoe and automatically attack enemies in range. This helps her kite Renekton, and when her cooldowns get back up, she uses Q and ults forward, leaving the crocodile with only a sliver of HP. But then a new challenger approaches, in the form of Akali, who gets immediately hit by the sleep. What is not immediate, however, is Faker's follow-up. Look at the screen and tell me, why did he not continue attacking Akali right after landing the sleep? This is because Zoe's Thresh was on the way, and the sleep lasted just long enough for him to land his hook and further lock up Akali, giving Faker a chance to completely burst her down. If he was impatient, his abilities would only end up bringing Akali to 20 to 30% HP, and she would have gotten away. After another successful kill and resetting, the opportunity presents itself once again. Faker sees Akali over the wall, does a first burst with Paddle Star, and hits her with the sleep immediately after. Then, he does something which is really only applicable in niche cases like this one. Namely, Faker queues forward instead of backwards. Because the sleep duration wouldn't last long enough for Paddle Star to be cast backwards, luckily Zoe is so far ahead that she can still delete Akali, even with a short distance on Q and Portal Jump. Only 10 seconds later, one of the last crucial fights of the game happens, and Faker is there to help. What he first does is throw a Paddle Star over the wall, but instead of hitting the low HP Renekton, he chooses to hit the Kindred instead. That's because the Kindred ult would have already saved Renekton, so he hits the healthy Kindred. He then strikes her with the sleep right after that, that way she has nowhere to go with 10% HP. The rest of the team cleans up, but Renekton is still somehow alive, so Faker decides to get ambitious. He places a really well-positioned Q behind the wall, ults forward, then flashes with Spell Thief to gain even more distance. However, even this ridiculous damage doesn't completely finish off Renekton, but if it did, it would have been a well-deserved highlight moment. The blue team continues to break the base and inhib off of the previously won teamfight, then rotates back to pick up Baron. They got stopped by the red team's desperate attempt to find a pick. With Kindred now eliminated, Zoe and the others finally finish off the purple worm, rotating bottom and ending the game. Thanks to Faker's excellent understanding of the Zoe vs. Akali matchup, he was able to constantly push out the waves and leave the lane to establish vision and gain advantages elsewhere on the map, while Akali was stuck lagging behind on farm and clear speed. Zoe's vision and ganks allowed the rest of the team to build up leads and create more pressure, eventually getting the victory. Whew, that was a lot of ground to cover, so let's recap and test your knowledge once again. What is Zoe's main objective in the matchup versus Akali? It's to push out the lane as fast as possible in order to establish priority and roam to put down vision or gank other lanes. Why does Faker decide against warding the river at 5:30? Because of two primary reasons. A, Akali is not level 6 yet, and the likelihood of Akali without alt roaming bot is almost zero, so she'll likely still be mid lane. B, Faker's jungler is currently ganking top lane and cannot help him if he gets caught. Why does he use the redemption on nothing but a minion wave? It's because one of the minions already had another spell to pick up, and also stolen spells and items only last 60 seconds. Faker had a bit more time left on redemption, but popping it onto the wave helps him with his primary goal of perma-pushing the wave and gives him another spell for free, so that's why he did it. What enabled him to use the extra long Q on the minion wave? Three enemies showed bot side and the enemy Renekton is dead, so he's pretty much alone in the mid lane, and that's why he was so comfortable using the full combo. If he didn't have vision over the enemies, this way of wave clearing would have been too risky. Why does he push so far into the enemy bottom lane? Because he has the help of Nidalee directly next to him, and besides that, he's also the highest level out of everybody in the game, so even if he gets collapsed on, he will be able to fight. Why did he not all in Akali after hitting her with the sleep? Because Thresh was on his way, and the sleep lasted just long enough for him to land his hook and further lock up the Akali. It gives Faker a chance to completely burst her down. If he was too impatient, his abilities would only have brought her to 20 or 30% HP, and she would have gotten away. Thank you for watching our entire in-depth analysis of Faker's Zoe. We hope that you learned something new. Once again, you can subscribe to our YouTube channel or visit ProGuides.com for more high-level League of Legends. On ProGuides.com, we've partnered with pro players to create courses designed to help you take your game to the next level, so don't miss out on that. Good luck on the Rift, and we will see you all next time.